I want to welcome you to the first episode of Under the Radar, where the latest news and rumors in the smaller weight divisions are discussed. In today's hit list, we have Kazuto Ioka versus Naoya Inoue, a battle brewing amongst two Japanese juggernauts, the return of a Mexican buzzsaw in Julio Cesar Martinez at flyweight, and Rey Vargas leaving the super bantamweight division and what name he is looking to go after at featherweight, plus much more. I want to thank you all again for tuning in and remind you to subscribe to stay up to date with the latest news from an unbiased point of view. Let's get right down to it. Highly regarded and a former minimum weight, light flyweight, flyweight, and current super flyweight champion of the world, Kazuto Ioka is fresh off perhaps one of his best wins, if not his best win, in Kosei Tanaka. In that fight, he executed an elegant and sophisticated game plan that proved too precise for a younger Tanaka. According to Kazuto Ioka's legendary trainer in Ismael Salas, Ioka has made it clear that he is looking to retire in the not-so-distant future, but the 31-year-old tactician is looking to make history by attempting to have one last run at bantamweight, making it his fifth weight division, which is historical for Japanese boxing, and it's also the home of Naoya the Monster Inoue. Ismael said the following to Boxing Scene. After the fight, he said that he does not want to fight in Japan anymore and that he wants to finish his career by fighting in the United States. There are several big fights that can be made at 115 and 118 pounds, including a showdown against Naoya Inoue, which I think would interest the fans. Nevertheless, it is a great fight, a phenomenal fight, a historic fight for Japan, as well as the world of boxing in general. I think the fact that Kazuto Ioka is trying to finish off his career in the United States at the age of 31 right now, I think is a little bit too late for him to be able to become a star or develop some type of following in the Western Hemisphere. Nevertheless, he is a really good talent. He could potentially squeeze another 2-3 years out of his career and make some decent paydays out here in the United States. The only unfortunate thing about the whole ordeal is he should have done it when he was younger. Nevertheless, he was able to make history even by staying in his homeland, but he could have had a lot of different opportunities for bigger paydays if he would have made the jump sooner. I agree with his trainer, there is a lot of options at 115 and at 118, so I'm sure that he's going to be able to gift us at least a few more treats before he calls it a day. Now, Naoya Inoue would be facing a huge challenge in an accurate and methodical Ioka with an educated left hook that's shrouded in nuances. He is very talented, he is very methodical, so that would be a phenomenal fight. Not only that, but it would be a fight of experience against youth, a historic fight for Japan, like I stated earlier, and the sport itself. However, Ioka's trainer is a bit concerned about his move up to bantamweight and how he would look like in the new weight division. Not only that, but the fact that Ioka wants to end his career outside of the comfort of his home soil could pose a few other logistical issues with the fight getting made. Moving on, Naoya Inoue is back and will be facing his mandatory in Michael, get this guys, hot and spicy, Das Marinas. Although it is a relatively lesser opponent for the likes of Naoya Inoue, who is a top 3 pound for pound fighter. By the way, side note, I also made a video on Naoya Inoue being a top 3 pound for pound fighter, so check that out if you get the chance. Back on topic, it is nonetheless a mandated defense and he is looking to dispose of the hot streaking Filipino challenger in front of his home crowd back in Japan. Apparently though, the fight seems to be facing some complications due to travel restrictions imposed on the Philippines and its natives by Japan due to the coronavirus pandemic. Regardless, I hope Naoya is able to get this fight secured and over with in order for him to move forward with either facing John Riel Casimero, with whom he has unfinished business with, or give Kazuto Ioka a crack at history by offering him a shot at his unified titles. I think Naoya disposes of Michael in 2-4 rounds to defend his IBF belt. Now, let's head south of the border with the next bit of information. We are looking at perhaps one of the most entertaining active boxers in the world, the kid with the chip on his shoulders and rocks for hands in Julio Cesar El Rey Martinez. the WBC has ordered a mandatory defense for Martinez, and it comes in the form of Puerto Rican slugger McWilliams Arroyo. Although Martinez was slated to face off against fellow Mexican brethren in Francisco Chivas Rodriguez on the Canelo Calum undercard, unfortunately that fight fell through due to a non-COVID related illness that Martinez contracted. But now Martinez is looking to be back, and he is facing a serious challenger. Although Arroyo does have 4 losses on his record, do not be deceived. That win, but I think this will most definitely provide some great entertainment. Now, Rey Vargas is packing up and moving 4 pounds north to become the WBC featherweight challenger, meaning he could be the name Gary Russel Jr. faces for his ritualistic annual title defense. Although Vargas is relatively talented, I think Gary's hand speed and angles will prove too much for Vargas, especially since he is moving up. Although Vargas is a big guy, so it might pose some issues for the small in stature Gary Russel Jr. Although this isn't the fight that Gary Russel Jr. wants himself, since he has his sights fixed on Davis and Leo Santa Cruz, I think this fight would suit him best. Leo is coming off a brutal loss, and Davis, from my opinion, is too big, too fast, and too sharp for Russell's skills to overcome. Not only that, but I want to see Tank Davis compete against other